Hello everyone, welcome to PRV Solution. Today we will study LTI systems. So firstly we will study system. What is a system? A system produces an output signal in response to stimulus from an input signal. Basically a system always produces an output when we will give an input to the system. So it produces output when we will give input, but we have to study here LTI. LTI means linear time invariant systems. So what is a linear time invariant system? A linear system produces an output that is linear function of the input. A linear system always produces a linear output with respect to input, means if you are increasing input 5 times, then output will also increase 5 times. If you are increasing your input 10 times, output will increase 10 times. Then we have time invariant. What is time invariant system? It produces an output that is not explicitly depend on time. A time invariant system means that will not depend upon time, means a time shifted input results in an only time shifted output. Whatever time shift will occur at your input side, it will occur at the output also. So this is the time invariant system. So a LTI system is that which follows both these properties, linearity and time invariant. So now we will study linear functions. What is a linear function? A function is said to be linear if it follows this property, function ax plus y is equal to a function x plus function y, where x, y are the dependent variable and a is constant. So linear function must follow these two properties further: scaling property and additive property. Scaling property means function of ax is equal to a of function x, where a is a scalar constant, while additive property means function x1 plus x2 is equal to function of x1 plus function of x2. Here scaling means whatever scaling you are doing in at the input side, it will produce the same scaling at the output side. In case of additive property, means that if you are giving two signals simultaneously, then the output is equal to the sum of the individual responses from the systems. Fx1, suppose you are giving signals x1, it is producing fx1, and if you are giving a signal fx2, it is producing output y2. Means output due to x1 is y1 and output due to x2 is y2. But when we are giving here combined input, that is x1 plus x2, so it must be the sum of the output, that is y1 plus y2. So now the question is whether this function is a linear function. It is a linear function. It is a linear function because it represents straight line, but it is not a linear system. It is not a linear system because it will not follow these two properties. You can understand it by yourself. Next is scaling property. In case of scaling property, suppose we have a system and we are giving xt and it is producing output yt. But if the system is scalable, means input is scaled to c, c is a constant, c can be greater than 1 or c can be less than 1, then system must produce cyt, means whatever scaling you are doing at input side, it must produce the same scaling at the output side. suppose we have a linear system here. Now we are giving here input as this signal and we are getting output as this signal. So suppose you will scale it to 2, then output will also get scaled to 2. If you are scaling it to half, then output or also scale to half. So this is the case of the scaling property. Now we will study that this differential system is scalable or not, where x t is input, y t is output. So suppose we have a system, we have to measure this system scalability. So you can use here x is equal to c x and y is equal to c y and do some calculations, then you will find that this system is a scalable system, because whatever scaling we are doing at input side, we are getting same scaling at the output side, x is equal to c x and y is equal to c y. Additive property. As I earlier explained it, x 1 t produces y 1 t and x 2 t produces y 2 t. So if I will combine both of these signal, x 1 t and x 2 t, that is this x 1 t plus x 2 t, it must produces sum of the output y 1 t plus y 2 t. If any system that follows properties, this property, then that is also a linear system. It is also known as superposition property. An example is shown in the figure. Here we have to calculate the current through this R2 resistance. So firstly, what we will do? We will short this voltage source and find the current, this I1, through this R2 branch. So this will, you can find out using current divider rule. So here current will becomes current will comes out to be 2 ampere. While calculating response due to this 45 volt, we will open it and find out the current due to this power supply, that is V0 by R1 plus R2, which is comes out to be minus 3 ampere. So total current through R2 is, due to this is 2 ampere and due to this is minus 3 ampere. It is the combined sum, that is minus 1 ampere. So this value I comes out to be minus 1 ampere. So this is the example of additive property. In this slide, we will study time invariant system. A system is time invariant if a time shift in the input results only in the same time shift in the output. Whatever time shift we are doing at the input side, it must occur at the output side. Suppose we have a signal x t as input and y t as output, and if the system is time invariant, then a time shifted input produces a time shifted output. Here t is the delay by which we are shifting our input signal. This is the example. This is a time shifted input. It produces a time shifted output at t time. T is the delay. So this is about the time invariant systems. So what is the conclusion basically in our measurement system? In any linear time invariant measuring system, so we are dealing here instrumentation or instruments which are measuring systems. So these systems are linear and time invariant. The following general relation can be written between input and output for time t greater than equal to 0. This is a differential equation corresponds to our LTI measuring system, where QI, this is our QI, is the measured quantity, and Q0 is the output reading, and A0, B0, AN, BM are the constants. So the conclusion of this LTI measuring system is that only that we can represent any LTI measuring system with a corresponding differential equation. All the differential equation of this type are the linear time invariant represents the linear time invariant measuring systems. So, we can represent a LTI system with this type of differential equations. This is about the LTI systems. Today we will study time domain analysis. So, actually what is time domain analysis? It is the study of response of different types of instrument when the measurement applied to them varies. Means it describes the dynamic characteristics of the instrument. Means we have dynamic characteristics, and that is our input varies with respect to time, and we have to study instrument characteristics how the output of instrument varies with respect to time when our input changes in time domain. So, first point, dynamic characteristics of instruments are described by time domain analysis. Second point, the dynamic characteristics of a measuring instrument describe its behavior between the time a measured quantity changes value and the time when the instrument output attains a steady value in response. Third point is, time domain analysis is the study of response of different types of instrument when the input changes with respect to time or measurement applied to them varies. The fourth point is, the measurement system may be subjected to any type of input, and these inputs can be in the form of this unit step function, unit ramp function and unit impulse function. So, overall time domain analysis describes the instrument characteristics when input changes with respect to time, and we have to calculate how the output changes with respect to time when input changes. In previous slides, we studied that a linear time invariant measuring system described by this differential equation. It is a constant coefficient differential equation, and initial conditions are assumed to be 0 to work this equation in LTI domain. Here QI is the measured quantity and QO is the output reading, and others A naught, A n, B naught, B m are constants. Now, zero order system. This is the differential equation. Zero order means all the higher order derivatives are 0, means these derivatives and these derivatives are 0 here. So, we have equation this A naught Q naught is equal to B naught Q I, or output is equal to B naught by A naught into Q I, where B naught and A naught are constant. So, they can be represented by K, where K is constant known as instrument sensitivity. So, zero order system is one in which higher order or all the derivatives are 0. Any instrument that behaves according to this equation is said to be of zero type, zero order type, following a step change in the measured quantity at time t. The instrument output moves immediately to a new value at the same time instant t, because this B naught, A naught are constant, K is constant. So, output directly varies with input. How our input changes, output will follow that instantly. So, this is the zero order instrument equations. So now we will see the example of the zero order instrument. Equation 2.3 is a simple algebraic equation, and therefore no matter how the input qi varies with time, the output follows it perfectly and faithfully. This means that the neither there is a distortion nor any time lag. A linear potentiometer is an example of a zero order system. This is our potentiometer, this is output voltage, and this is the displacement. We are varying here displacement with time and calculating E naught. So this curve is straight line. So as our input changes, we are getting output simultaneously. Here EB is supply voltage to potentiometer in volt, L is length of potentiometer in meter, XIT is the displacement of sliding contact at time t, E naught is the output voltage at time t, that is volt. Since the resistance of potentiometer is linearly distributed along its length, the voltage per unit length is E naught or EB by L. This so output voltage we can measure, this is our resistance or voltage per unit length multiply with length of the sliding contact, it will give us output voltage which is equal to S. This is constant E B and L, S X I T is our displacement which we will vary with time. So, this S is a new parameter which is known as sensitivity, it is equal to E B by L volt per meter. So, from equation 24.31 it is clear that linear relationship exists between the displacement and the output voltage. In fact, resistance potentiometer is not truly a zero order system. This potentiometer is not an example of a truly zero order system, because here we are taking assumptions which we will see in next slide. So this is our output, it directly varies with input, so there is no time lag present. First assumption is the potentiometer has finite number of turns, infinite number of turns, and therefore we get an absolute linear relationship between displacement x and output voltage E naught. So we are assuming here that our potentiometer has infinite number of turns, but in actual practice potentiometer have a finite number of turns, and therefore we get a stepped curve depicting the relationship between output and voltage, output voltage and input displacement, which is shown here. So actual output voltage vary with respect to distance stepwise. Second assumption is the measuring device connected at the output terminal has an infinite impedance. The device which you will connect to find out the output has infinite impedance, we are assuming this, but actually this output device has a finite impedance due to which there are loading effect. This results in a non-linear relationship between input and output. So here also we are getting non-linear relationship due to finite impedance of our measuring device. The winding of potentiometer is not purely resistive. What we are assuming here, there are inductive and capacitive effects, and hence the simplified resistive model is not valid. And fourth assumption is there are mechanical loading effects due to inertia of sliding contact and friction. This will also creates non-linearity between the output and input. So from above regions, even a resistive potentiometer cannot be considered as a zero order instrument, but it is one of the system which closely approximate a zero order system. So it is a best example of zero order system if we will take these assumptions. Now we will see first order instrument. फर्स्ट ऑर्डर सिस्टम्स और इंस्ट्रूमेंट्स आर कॉमनली फाउंड इन मेजरिंग सिस्टम्स. द हाइएस्ट ऑर्डर ऑफ डेरिवेटिव इन फर्स्ट ऑर्डर सिस्टम इज 1. एग्जाम्पल ऑफ ए फर्स्ट ऑर्डर सिस्टम इज ए कॉमन RC सर्किट विच इज शोन इन द फिगर. इनपुट वोल्टेज RC आउटपुट एंड हेयर द कर्व डेपिकेट्स द करंट विच वेरीज विद टाइम E/R e^-t/τ. सो एक्चुअली वट आर फर्स्ट ऑर्डर इंस्ट्रूमेंट. फर्स्ट ऑर्डर इंस्ट्रूमेंट्स इफ द LTI इक्वेशन और डिफरेंशियल इक्वेशन वी ओन हैव ओनली फर्स्ट ऑर्डर डेरिवेटिव प्रेजेंट एंड हायर ऑर्डर ऑर्डर डेरिवेटिव्स आर 0, देन वी विल गेट फर्स्ट ऑर्डर इंस्ट्रूमेंट. मीन्स ओनली दिस विल प्रेजेंट हेयर. मीन्स फर्स्ट ऑर्डर डेरिवेटिव इज प्रेजेंट, अदर हायर ऑर्डर डेरिवेटिव्स आर 0. सो वी विल गेट फर्स्ट ऑर्डर सिस्टम. So we will find the response of this system with input. So how our output varies when our input varies, means we have to calculate the response of this system. Let the current in the circuit be IT at an instant t is equal to t. So all initial condition are assumed to be 0, which is a necessary condition for differential equation to become linear. So we will get E I U T R I T plus 1 by C integration of I D T. And if we will take the Laplace transform of the above equation, then we will get this equation E I by S R I S, means time domain is converted into frequency domain. So from this equation we will get E I and IS relationship, and then IS can be calculated. This IS can be seen into EI upon 1 plus RCS or EI upon R. If you will take R common from this, then we have EI upon R 1 upon S plus 1 by RC. And we will take now inverse Laplace transform. After taking inverse Laplace transform, we will get value of current in time domain, which is equal to EI by R e^-t/τ. Where tau is the time constant of the circuit RC, which is same as this. So in this way we can find the current from the circuit. Now we will calculate the output voltage across the capacitor E0t, which is equal to 1 by C integration of I D T. If we will differentiate this equation, we will get d e naught t by dt is equal to 1 by C I. Value of I we calculated earlier. This we will put this value in this equation. Then we have this representation of derivative of e naught t. When we will take Laplace transform, we will get E naught S is equal to E input S 1 plus S tau. After factorization, we will get 1 by S minus tau by 1 plus S tau. And if we will take inverse Laplace transform of this equation, we will get output voltage, which is given by input 1 minus E^-t/τ. It is the rising exponential. So in this way output tracks the input with an error of 1 minus E^-t/τ. The variation of voltage across capacitor with time is shown in the figure. So this is the output voltage what we want to calculate across the capacitor when our input varies as a step response. Let us take a general look of the transfer function for first order. This is the first order equation, and after dividing this all equation with A naught, we will get this equation. This A1 by A naught is known as tau which is known as time constant, and S is B naught by A naught which is static sensitivity. Time constant tau has always the dimensions of time. The static sensitivity has dimensions of output divided by input. So, taking Laplace transform of the earlier equation, we will get transfer function Gs is equal to Cs upon Rs, output upon input, which is equal to S upon 1 plus tau S, and the dimensions less transfer function is Gs by S, S is equal to 1 by 1 plus tau S. This is the dimensionless transfer function. So, now we will subject this system to with an input of unit step input. We will apply here unit step input to first order system. So, first order system transfer function is 1 upon 1 plus tau S, and here RT is UT, which is unit step input, and RS or corresponding Laplace transform of this input is 1 by S. So, after factorization and taking inverse Laplace transform, we will get output 1 minus e raised to power minus t by tau, and this is the output 1 minus e raised to power t by tau, which is increasing exponential, and it will meet the input after some time here. So, initial slope you can calculate at t is equal to 0 dc by dt, derivative of output with respect to time at t is equal to 0, taking derivative and after putting the value of 0, we will get 1 by tau. So, if the initial rate of change is maintained, the system will reach its final value in time tau, the time constant. Ct is equal to 1 minus e raised to power minus t by tau, which is equal to 0.632. It is the time constant. So, what is time constant here? Here we have a definition of time constant. For rising exponent function, it is defined as the time to reach 63.2% of its final value. Here, this is the time constant, 63.2% of its final value, while in case of decaying exponent function, it is defined as the time taken to fall 36.8% of its final value. When its final value will fall to 36.8%, it is shown in next slide. This is the 36.8% where our system will fall from its initial value, from its final value to 36.8%. So, this is the T, which is known as time constant. So, now we can calculate the dynamic error. What is dynamic error? Input minus output. So, input in time is 1, as we are applying unit step input is always 1, and output which we already calculated here, Ct 1 minus e raised to power minus t by tau. So, this error will comes out to be e raised to power minus t by tau under steady state condition. Means steady state means when this t becomes infinite, then this error becomes 0. So, first order system tracks the unit step input with 0 static error. So, this is the first order system. It always tracks the unit step input with 0 static error. Under which condition? Under steady state condition, when time is infinite. When time is infinite, then this output will track input with 0 error. Now, we will study response of first order system to ramp input. Here output and input or output tracks the input with steady state error tau, while in earlier cases when our first order system was subjected to step input, this error was 0 at steady state condition. Now we are giving here RT is equal to T, while in last case it was 1. That is, now it is unit ramp, and the corresponding Laplace transform of unit ramp is 1 by s square. So transfer, this is the transfer function. When we will calculate by the value of output in terms of time after taking Laplace transform, then finding the inverse Laplace transform of the equation, we will get the output Ct is equal to T minus tau 1 minus E minus T by tau. This is the final output when our first order system is subjected to ramp input. Now measurement error or dynamic error can be calculated, RT minus CT, which comes out to be tau times 1 minus e raised to power minus t by 2. And at steady state condition, when we will put this t infinite, we will get error is tau. So it will track, this output will track our input with all with the steady state error of tau always. So the tracking error here is tau, while in earlier cases it was 0 at steady state condition. Now we will study second order instrument. What are the second order instrument? Second order instruments are those in which higher order derivative of the differential equation is 2. So this is the corresponding LTI equation, differential equation for LTI system of the second order system. Derivative of this system is m, this represent double derivative, this represents x dot t represents single derivative. So after taking Laplace transform, we can find the transfer function of the second order instrument. So this is the transfer function for the second order instrument. Now normalized normalized or dimensionless transfer function is given by fs by xs divided by k, and these terms, when we k by m is known as omega n square, s square plus 2 zeta omega n s plus omega n square, means we can convert our second order instrument system's transfer function in this form always, where omega n is natural frequency in radian per second, tau is damping ratio, which is equal to d by 2 under root k times m. Now we can define the static sensitivity, s is equal to b naught by a naught. Natural frequency, we already know this omega n under root k by m, a naught by a 2. So static sensitivity from this b naught by a naught is the static sensitivity. While this natural frequency, how we can calculate a naught by a 2, this is a naught by a 2 is the natural frequency, and this damping ratio is d by 2 under root km. So similarly, we can find damping ratio in terms of coefficients of the differential equation. For mechanical rotation system, we have these term for the omega n and zeta. Zeta is known as damping ratio here. So, a non-dimensionalized transfer function of a second order system is described as g s is equal to omega n square s square plus 2 zeta omega n s plus omega n square. So, actually what we are doing here, we are calculating here response of the second order system. So, response of second order systems are always described by this equation, s square plus 2 zeta omega n s omega n square. This is also known as characteristic equation, and these roots of this equation determines the response of the system. At it is of second order equation. So these equation have two different roots, s 1 and s 2, which are as follows. So there are three cases we can have here. We may have a overdamped system. We will see in next slide what are the physical significance of these overdamped, critical damped and underdamped systems. So in case of overdamped system, value of zeta is greater than 1, and the two roots are real and unequal. Here the roots you will find real and unequal, and the response is given here. For unit step input we can calculate the response as this. CT is in time domain output of the our this system. For critically damped system zeta is equal to 1. If zeta is equal to 1, then we have roots are equal and real, which are always equal to minus of omega n, means both of the roots are equal to omega n. The equation for the response or output of the response equation of the system is CT is equal to 1 minus 1 plus omega n t e raised to power minus omega n t. And similarly, we have underdamped system. In this case, zeta is less than 1. Here also, we will get unequal roots, and these roots are complex conjugated to each other. Here we are getting a new terms omega d. Omega d is equal to omega n under root of 1 minus zeta square. This omega d is known as damped natural frequency, and value is given by this equation. Note here, the measurement systems are underdamped in almost all the applications. Therefore, study of response of second order system where the roots are complex conjugate pair is very important. So, it is very important to study this underdamped system. So, in this lecture we also find the response of an underdamped system in next slides. So, this shows the physical significance of our system according to damping. So, here what is the damping? Damping decides the quickness with which the moving system settles to its final steady state. Means we have our a moving system, and how it will how quickly it will settle to a final or steady state value. So, damping decides it. Critically damped system reaches the final steady state smoothly without oscillations. So, this is the curve for critical damped oscillation or system. So, here it will reach the steady state value earlier as compared to both underdamped and overdamped system, and the steady state value it will get smoothly without any oscillations, as we can see in figure. There is no oscillation present for the critical damping. And underdamped system will oscillate about final steady state with decreasing amplitude and take some time to rest. So, this is the curve for underdamped system. So, before reaching to final state value, it will oscillate and it will take some time to reach at the rest or final value. And the third is overdamped system. It will reach the final steady state value very slowly. So, this is the curve for overdamped system. It will reach the final value very slowly. So, in this way damping decides how our system will reach its final value with respect to inputs. So, as we study that the response of underdamped system is very important. So, this is the response for underdamped system for a unit step input. As we seen in last slides that underdamped system's roots are always complex conjugate each other. So, after taking the inverse Laplace transform of those roots, we will get this equation where phi is cos inverse zeta. It is also equal to tangent inverse 1 minus zeta square upon zeta. So, this is the final expression for the underdamped second order system. So, we can calculate here also dynamic error or measurement error, which is equal to RT minus CT, means input minus output, which comes out to be this term. And under steady state condition, when we will put T is equal to infinity, this error also becomes 0. So, thus when the steady state error of a second order system to a unit step input is 0. So, here steady state error for the second order system is always 0, means सेकेंड ऑर्डर सिस्टम ऑल्सो ट्रैक्स इट्स इनपुट विदाउट एनी एरर एट स्टडी स्टेट एंड द फाइनल स्टडी स्टेट वैल्यू बिकम्स इक्वल टू वन हेयर. This is the steady state condition. So, actually, what we are doing here by time domain analysis means we are measuring the response of our system. Our system may be a first order system, may be a second order system, and depending upon the inputs applied to the system. These systems can be subjected to inputs of step input, ramp input, and unit impulse inputs. So, we are measuring here how our output varies with input, while our input is changing with respect to time, or input varies with time. So, how much our system is able to track the input. For example, in this case, second order system at steady state, this tracks its input without error. While in earlier case, in when we are applying ramp input, there was error of tau is the error at steady state input. When we are subjecting our first order system with step input, the steady state error there was also zero. So, in this way we can find the behavior of our measuring instrument. Systems are here nothing but here the system means we are using here a term measuring instrument or tools. These are the same as the systems. So, we are finding the behavior of our measuring system for varying inputs. This is all about the time domain analysis. Thanks for watching.